What's going on, guys? I know the video was titled My Top 20 Video Games of All Time, and I'll get to that shortly. I'd just like to take a couple of seconds here at first to thank you guys for how well received my Ancestry video was. I was pleasantly surprised at the conversation that it generated on the page. I was pleasantly surprised by the amount of views, and I was pleasantly surprised by the amount of thumbs up and subscriptions I got from it. So I kind of feel like the bar has been risen a little higher because of that. So I'll try to do my best going forward. The video you're about to watch is a lot longer and a little more involved. It took me probably about 3 months to put together. Again, I thank you guys, and I hope you're entertained. So without any further ado, I will turn it over from me to me.
Good afternoon, fellow YouTubers and gamers. It's BM151. To those of you who have subscribed, you know that I'm a fan of art, comedy, music, humor, and also top 20 lists. Thank you for your sub, and to the new viewers out there, this is just a little bit of what I'm about. Today, we're going to get into gaming, specifically my top 20 favorite video games of all time. I will be dating myself a little bit in this video, and there will definitely be some spoilers. But anyway, I hope you do enjoy, and we'll get started. So number 20, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, specifically the arcade version. This game was developed and distributed by the Konami Holdings Corporation, which is based in Tokyo, Japan. They've produced many toys, cartoons, and video games throughout the years. Any of you who had an 8-bit Nintendo Entertainment System like I did growing up might note that they also produced other awesome video games like Castlevania and Contra, just to name a couple. So, also, to anyone who was born and grew up in the 1980s, you knew of and were likely a huge fan of the action-adventure cartoon series, the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. As with the cartoon, the game has four main protagonists. We have our level-headed leader of the team, Leonardo, who wears a blue mask and whose weapon of choice was two katana. Next, we have the lighthearted party animal of the group, who often, if not always, spoke in surfer slang. You'd get at least one cowabunga from him per episode if you were a fan of the show like I was. Our orange mask protagonist named Michelangelo, whose signature weapon, nunchucks. Third, we have Donatello, the purple mask protagonist and my personal favorite of the group, both on the show and in the game, and his weapon of choice was a bow staff. Fans will note that Donatello was the tech geek and the inventor of the group. I always chose to play as him in the arcade version of the game because although his attacks were kind of slower than his teammates, that bow staff had great range and it really served as a repellent to most of the enemies if you knew how to position yourself correctly. Last but not least, we have our red mask turtle, Raphael, whose signature weapon was two sai. Fans of the show would note that he was the comedian of the group, giving many sarcastic and witty remarks on the show, which often broke the fourth wall. This game breaks the fourth wall as well. Anyway, the player, when they play the game, they choose to be any one of the Ninja Turtles. You can see that this game is in four-player mode. The objective of the game is to retrieve two characters, their best friend, reporter April O'Neil, and their mentor, Master Splinter, from the Evil Shredder. In the game, the turtles give chase, they fight, they save their friends, and eventually defeat Shredder. Like most arcade games back then, the 8-way joystick controlled the movements of the first-person fighting game, and there was a jump and attack button, which you could also use as a combo for specific attacks if you had to. I loved this game growing up, and to those of you out there, and there's probably none of you, but to those of you out there who grew up in the small town of Peru, Illinois, like I did, you'll note that there was an arcade in the Peru Mall known as the Gold Mine. I absolutely loved the Gold Mine when I was a kid. I spent so much, if not all of my allowance in that place, likely on about one day, and I remember that this game was located right in the center, and it was always packed. Whenever someone ran out of lives and left the machine, I'd always try to jump in there. This was one of the first games, too, that I considered to be extremely interactive, and I love how they broke the fourth wall. You know, notably, when your character is immobile for too long, he just looks at you, like Leonardo is doing right there. It's almost like the developers were just nodding towards you at that point. So that's number 20. Moving on to number 19.
And how could you not love Pac-Man? In 1980, this game was developed by Namco. Like number 20, they are also rooted in Tokyo, Japan, and they decided to distribute this gem into the United States in 1982, I think? Pac-Man is universally known and loved, and has been referenced in much media and entertainment in the last 35 years, as you guys know. I think what makes Pac-Man so appealing is that for a simple-looking maze game, it has much personality. And it really tests your timing and reflexes towards eating whatever those pellets consisted of and evading all those pesky ghosts, of which there were my personal favorite, Clyde, the orange ghost. He was the least threatening nemesis of the game due to his lazy pursuance of Pac-Man. He was never really much of a threat and he was definitely the dim-witted ghost of the group. Next, we had Pinky. Pinky was really kind of more annoying than the other ghosts in the game in that he always tried to just get in front of you. Like Clyde, he really never got me that often. Inky and Blinky, on the other hand, I would sometimes have problems with, especially as the game progressed. Inky was the blue ghost, and he was the unpredictable one of the group. You never knew whether he'd aggressively pursue you or just wander off. If I died in the game, like I said, it would either be at his hands or at Blinky's. The red ghost, the leader of the pack, I hated that sucker. He was the most aggressive, and when I got stuck in a corner as the game was progressing into the higher levels and I saw him in my peripheral, I knew it was pretty much over. One particularly fond memory that I have of this game is that when I was a kid hanging out at Oogie's Restaurant, that's OOGIE's in LaSalle County, Illinois, I said I was going to date myself on this video a little bit, and here we go again. I was about 5 years old, and I remember this little boy playing Pac-Man flawlessly for probably like 20-25 minutes, and I never saw anyone get that far on a video game before. And unfortunately, I had to leave with my parents because they had already paid the dinner tab, and I remember being so mad that I didn't get to see this kid finish the game. Never knew his name, never really even met him, but if I had to guess, I'm sure he became some kind of video gaming prodigy or definitely got into video game development in some capacity. So to whoever you are, sir, you gave a good show and very talented for your age. There's number 19, so moving on to number 18. Number 18, Sonic the Hedgehog 2. For the third time on our list, we're headed back to Tokyo, Japan. This game was developed and distributed by the Sega Technical Institute in 1992. My mother, I believe later regretted doing so because I played this game so often, got me this in the Christmas of that year, and my brother and sister and I constantly played it on our then Sega Genesis, if any of you had that back in the day. The game's premise is similar to that of its predecessor. Sonic's nemesis, Dr. Robotnik, is again planning world domination with his army of robots and of the 7 Chaos Emeralds. The goal is to defeat Robotnik again, saving as many animals as possible and collecting all 7 emeralds. I chose this over the first Sonic, which I also loved, don't get me wrong, but I picked this one because there's so much more action and energy and intensity in this game, as you can see. I love the background music here, and I think it's Chemical Plant Zone. Sonic has a lot more speed and strength in this game too, if you just look at the ground that he covers in such a short amount of time. This game is also hilarious in that we now get to watch our sidekick, Tails, who the game deliberately uses as Sonic's assistant, try to keep up. Just good times across the board. Had so much fun playing this game as a kid. So moving on, number 17. Number 17, Super Punch-Out. In 1984, Elite Systems designed and published this awesome arcade boxing game. This would later be available on other platforms, such as the Commodore 16 and 64. As with the first Punch-Out, the player assumes the role of a green-haired boxer who would later in the Punch-Out series go on to be known as Little Mac. This player must time his punches, dodges, and blocks in order to defeat the opposing boxer, and the opponent would hint at his next attack by giving subtle eye changes whereby his eyes turn from white to yellow. It was then your job to counter the attack and react appropriately. So the goal of this game is to defeat 5 opponents to win the heavyweight belt. All 5 new characters in this game would make later appearances in the Punch-Out series. So first we have our hefty bearded defender from Canada known as Bear Hugger. Bear Hugger was easy to defend against as long as you knew how to time him and evade his bear hug attack. At 440 pounds though, if he landed that bear hug on you, you'd lose a pretty substantial amount of health. As a fan favorite of the series, he would make later appearances in the Super Nintendo Entertainment System's 1994 version of Punch-Out, as well as the Nintendo Wii 2009 version. So our second defender, Dragon Chan, hails from Hong Kong, China. Little side story about this game. I didn't know it existed until 1991, when my father had taken my siblings and I to Disney World, and halfway through the trip, we had had dinner one night, and we found ourselves congregated in this arcade in Magic Kingdom, and there it was, Super Punch-Out. Never knew it existed, so we had to play. Didn't know how many quarters we went through,
but we could not figure out that we had to duck to evade Dragon Chan's one-hit knockout kick. I hated that thing. And it was a pretty cheap move on the game's part, but, you know, we eventually found out that we had to duck and counter. Good times. Anyway, like Bear Hugger, Dragon Chan would make an appearance in the Super Nintendo Entertainment System's 1994 version of Punch-Out as well. Our third defender, controversially named Vodka Drunkensky, hailed from Russia. His name would be changed to Soda Popinski later in the series for obvious reasons. Vodka could be a tricky opponent due to his unpredictable timing, sneaky right jabs, and powerful uppercuts. Any fan of the Punch-Out series knows that he would make later appearances in Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, as well as the Nintendo Wii 2009 version. So our fourth defender, Great Tiger, hails from Bombay, India. Players would note that his signature move in this game was the rapid left and right Tiger Punch. It was kind of reminiscent of Piston Hurricane's Hurricane Rush in the first Punch-Out, but we'll get to that game later. Anyway, if Great Tiger ever landed that combo on you, it was not easy to evade, and it was pretty damaging to your health. Fans would note that he actually became a tougher opponent as the series progressed. You would see him again in Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, as well as the Nintendo Wii 2009 version. Our fifth and final defender, Hollywood, California, Super Macho Man, hated this guy. Hated him. He would go on to make more appearances in the Punch-Out series, and fans would note that he is usually one of the higher-ranking opponents in any given game. His unpredictable timing, strong right hooks, and that dreaded spin punch were always a problem for me. But that's why it always felt great when you finally beat him. So that was number 17. Number 16, Punch-Out. Going backwards in time, but forwards in the countdown. In 1983, Nintendo's integrated research and development team designed and published this arcade boxing game. The game's popularity would allow for further development and characters into the Punch-Out series, as you guys saw with number 17. As with number 17, the player must time his punches, dodges, and blocks in order to defeat the opposing boxer, and the opponent would again hit at his attacks by changing his eye color from white to yellow. Your job was to counter the attack and react appropriately, and the goal of this game is to defeat six opponents to win the heavyweight belt. Four of the six characters in the game would make later appearances in the Punch-Out series, not the least memorable of which character, hailing from Paris, France, was our first opponent, Glass Joe. What can you say about our friend from France? Well, he's lightweighted, he's slow, he stuns very easily, and he rarely attacks. Thus, he is super easy to defeat. You almost wonder why Joe would make so many more appearances in the series, as you would see him again in Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, and also the Nintendo Wii 2009 version of the game. Joe is always the first opponent to appear in the games that he does appear in, and you later note that he would appear with a record of 1-99, which, out of all the opponents, would make Joe the most experienced and yet the most defeated boxer, so it would almost beg the question, why does Joe keep boxing for a living? Well, I guess dude's a glutton for punishment. But perhaps that he was so masochistic is why he was also so memorable. You got a lot of heart, Joe. Moving on to our second defender from Havana, Cuba, Piston Hurricane. So a little side story about this game. We're going to take another trip back to the gold mine. My father would take me to this arcade as a kid, and I always wanted to play this game. The reason being that I would want to rematch Piston Hurricane because he always beat me with that stupid Hurricane Rush. And as a six-year-old kid, probably weighing all of about 40 pounds, I did not have the strength, the reflexes, or the agility on that joystick to withstand Mr. Hurricane and that stupid Hurricane Rush. And something about the look in his eyes when he went into that rush was intimidating but memorable. As with Dragon Chan, I would go through quarter after quarter after quarter to finally beat this guy, but it was so much fun. He would make another appearance in the Super Nintendo Entertainment System's 1994 version of the game, and come to think of it, I had a lot easier of a time with that version of Piston than this one. To my father, Pop, if you're out there listening, thank you for overextending my allowance back in the day. And we will always remember that the gold mine smelled like copper and popcorn. Moving on. So moving on to our third defender, hailing from Istanbul, Turkey, the unforgettable Bald Bull. Another in a series of memorable opponents, Baldy was always a tough customer. As the series progressed, he'd move further up the ladder in rank, as he was usually one of the last opponents to beat before attaining your heavyweight belt. Bald Bull would also make appearances in Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, the Super Nintendo Entertainment System's 1994 version of the game, and finally, the Nintendo Wii 2009 version. Well, Baldy wasn't messing around. At 6'2", 298 pounds, his landed punches did quite a bit of damage,
And how about that stupid bull charge? It sucked trying to time that thing. And he knew he was going to pull it when you'd start doing too much damage to him so he could take you down in one punch. But even so, that was just one of the elements that made the game more competitive and more fun. And it did feel great when you finally were able to sneak in that stomach jab on Mr. Bull to finally counter his bull charge attack. So moving on, our fourth defender, name of Kid Quick, hailing from Brooklyn, New York. I had a hard time with Mr. Quick when I played this game as a kid too. And the reason is he looks deceptively easy, as he has the exact frame of Glass Joe, but this was not the case. The name is pretty self-explanatory of his boxing style, very fast in both offense and defense. What I appreciated about Kid is that he was not flashy, pretentious, or grandstanding like a lot of other boxers in the series. Fans would note that he did not have a signature attack move, too. He just wanted to fight. Sadly, the developers never saw fit to reprise his character down the road, but he always gave me a hard time, so kudos, Mr. Quick, and rest in peace. Our fifth defender, hailing from Napoli, Italy, it was Pizza Pasta. Yes, Pizza Pasta. How stereotypically Italian can you get? But anyway, like Kid Quick, the developers never saw fit to reprise his character further into the series either. But even so, this dude was tough in the arcade version, and in hindsight, I may have never beat him now that I think about it. He was just as fast as Kid Quick, but he was bigger and stronger on top of it. Fans would remember the hold that he would put on you shortly into the first round, which if you were unlucky enough to get stuck in, you knew that that knockout uppercut punch was coming next. The strategy against Mr. Pasta would always be to use as much offense as possible. When he had an opening, you were best to just attack, as he was hard to counter. When and if you finally beat him, you'd get to our final defender from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, Mr. Sandman. Like Bald Bull, Sandman was always up the ladder in rank, as he was usually one of the last opponents to beat before attaining your heavyweight belt. Also like Bald Bull, Sandman would make appearances in Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, the Super Nintendo Entertainment System's 1994 version of the game, and finally the Nintendo Wii 2009 version. At 312 pounds, Sandman would do substantial damage if he landed a punch. Unlike the other characters in the game, there's no way to fake him out. Dude is very attentive, accurate, and arguably, in all versions of the Punch-Out series, the strongest. The best you could do was just wait for an opening, throw a punch, and hope for the best. If you were lucky enough to knock him down once, that would just piss him off and he would reemerge stronger. Beating Sandman does fulfill the player with a sense of accomplishment, though, because it is not easy to do. Needless to say, loved playing this game growing up, and here's to Popcorn, Copper, and the Goldmine. Moving on, number 15. Wonder Boy. I believe I got this game for my 6th birthday growing up, and again, like every other game you've seen on this list thus far, I spent a lot of time on this one too. Having spawned 5 sequels, Wonder Boy has aged gracefully, going through so many evolutions throughout the years as it was playable on the arcade version first, then Amstrad CPC, Atari ST, Commodore 64, Game Gear, the Sega Master System version, which is the one you're looking at here, the SG-1000, the Wii, the ZX Spectrum, and eventually the PlayStation 4. So Wonder Boy was developed in 1986 by Escape, Sega, and Activision collectively, and it is the player's job to guide the title character in his quest to rescue his girlfriend from the game's main boss, known as the Dark King, throughout 7 areas that each consisted of 4 rounds. The levels are made up of caves, forests, hills, ice palaces, mountain lands, oceans, etc. Like the typical platform game back then, the levels always ran from left to right, as you can see here. So, my younger sister and I used to play this game constantly when we went to my grandmom's house on the weekend, and we did it on a console that looked just like this. So to you youngins out there watching this video, I know that looks like a clunky system, but come to think of it, in hindsight, this system was way more stable than the Nintendo Entertainment System, because unlike the NES, it never started blinking on and off when you were far along into a given game, which would then have to cause you to blow into that stupid cartridge to clean it and make it work again. Anybody who grew up as a kid in the 1980s knows exactly what I'm talking about there. Anyway, what I loved about this game was its simplicity. There's nothing fancy, it's just your job to guide the player through the obstacles and get from point A to point B. And also, it looks awesome for 1986, and it has a childlike charm to it. You're just guiding a caveman, or more likely a cave kid, through the elements of the game, so it has a cartoon feel to it as well, just very lighthearted and relaxing. And also, this game holds a special place in my heart because it was the very first game that I ever beat, and I want to say it took me probably about 2 hours to do so. And my descent, as my uncle would put it, into video gaming had then begun. So that was number 15. Number 14.
Doom. Well, guys, any first-person shooter game fans out there likely knew this one was coming on the list. Id Software developed this game back in 1993, and much success has followed in its footsteps, as it has generated almost a dozen sequels and spin-offs to the present day. This game was originally playable via the Microsoft Disk Operating System, or MS-DOS, to those who remember. Eventually, that operating system would be superseded by Microsoft Windows 95, which I loved as a kid, probably because it was the longest-standing operating system on my family's household desktop growing up. And needless to say, once we had it, I'd play this game whenever I could. And yes, I know I'm dating myself again, but anyway. In a non-specifically identified point in the future, the player takes the role of a purposely unnamed space soldier who acts as a military policeman for the Union Aerospace Corporation. Our unnamed hero has been banned to Mars after assaulting his commanding officer. The Union Aerospace Corporation had been performing top-secret experiments with spatial teleportation by creating gateways between the moons of Mars, and in the process, the corporation winds up inadvertently causing their master computer to crash, which in turn causes an unidentified and homicidal evil that pours out of the gateway, and it manifests itself through a series of cyber demons and undead humans who plan to invade and eventually establish a hell on Earth. So what's not to love about this game? For starters, there weren't many like it at its inception. Our unnamed protagonist gives the player more of a sense of involvement in gaming survival. On a fun and playful note, Doom had more of an array of cheat codes than many games preceding it, and how awesome were all the weapons our protagonist could have in his arsenal at one time. Between the shotgun, the chainsaw, the chain gun, the plasma rifle, the rocket launcher, and likely everyone's personal favorite, the BFG 9000, there was not much you could not destroy in this game. It just got the virtual adrenaline going, and it had a very 1990s feel to it. And how about the music, too? If you listen closely here, you can tell that the backtrack in the first level, the composers were definitely Metallica fans. Of course, this game would not have dawned at all if our next game in the countdown didn't either. Number 13, Wolfenstein. So we continue along the first-person shooter genre. As with number 14, Id Software developed this game back in 1992, and the game was actually inspired by Castle Wolfenstein, which was a stealth-based action-adventure shooter game set in World War II. This game was also playable via MS-DOS, and would eventually be playable on other platforms such as the Super Nintendo Entertainment System, Jaguar, GBA, 3DO, Windows Mobile, iOS, PlayStation 3, and finally the Xbox 360. So what is our objective here? Set during World War II, the player takes on the role of protagonist William Blazkowicz, a Polish-American spy who has been imprisoned by the SS in the 1940s. Blazkowicz has been captured while trying to obtain the SS's plans for Operation Iron Fist, and it is the player's job to safely extract him from Castle Wolfenstein as well as other compounds and levels. The player must fight off the SS guards and other enemies while trying to maintain ammunition and health. It is easy for the player's health to fall to zero in this game, as his enemies are pretty relentless. If the player loses a life, he will start the current level over armed with just a Luger pistol and a knife. However, other weapons are obtainable, such as the submachine gun and the rapid-firing chain gun. There are also many obtainable secrets and treasures throughout the game as well. Each episode has a different boss who must be killed in the final mission to complete said episode. What I really loved about this game was how spatial it was, especially as you progressed into the later rounds. The levels covered a lot of ground, and it was really easy to get lost. Sometimes you'd dispose of most of the enemies within a given level and just walk around trying to find the boss so you could progress to the next round. When this happened, an unsettling quiet came about the game and made you anticipate what was going to happen next. The enemies in this game were very stealth and sneaky, and once they saw you, they'd aggressively pursue. The bosses in this game are only drawn from one angle as well, which means they're always facing the player, so they cannot be taken by surprise. What's eerie, too, is that they are always stationary and do not become active until they see the player, so this game is really a sense of one's timing, memory, and reflexes. Though this game speaks to a real, yet tragic point in American and European history, it does have a sense of humor. When the bosses die, as you see Hitler does right here, a replay, called the Death Cam, of the boss's death is shown and the episode ends. Awesome game, and like number 14, it paved the way for a lot of first-person shooter games to follow. Number 12. Mortal Kombat 2. So, back to the competitive fighting game genre. Well, anyone and everyone knows of the Mortal Kombat series, as it has spawned over 20 video games and has been prevalent throughout film, literature, music, and television for about the past 25 years. It was almost impossible for me to pick just one of the Mortal Kombat games for number 12, but here it is. I chose the 1993 Sega Genesis version of the game. Anyone familiar with the first Mortal Kombat, which came out the year prior, you'll remember that Liu Kang had defeated the game's main antagonist, Shang Tsung, in Mortal Kombat, thus saving the Earthrealm from the invasion of Outworld. Shang Tsung then begs his master, Shao Kahn, for a second chance, and Kahn obliges by establishing a second tournament by which he extends the invitation to the Thunder God and Earthrealm's protector, Raiden, who again gathers his warriors and takes them into Outworld. Our returning characters consist of Liu Kang, who's probably my first of three favorite playable characters in the game, a Shaolin monk who is the reigning champion of Mortal Kombat. He travels again to Outworld to seek vengeance for the death of his Shaolin monastery brothers. He is aided again by Hollywood actor and martial artist Johnny Cage. Our third returning character in the game, Sub-Zero, and that would be my second favorite of the playable characters in the game. Sub-Zero is our cryokinetic ninja who apparently was not killed in the first tournament. He returns to Outworld to again attempt assassination on Shang Tsung. Shang Tsung, as mentioned before, does return, as does Raiden, our Thunder God, who returns to Mortal Kombat to stop Khan's evil plans of taking Earthrealm for his own. Reptile, Shang Tsung's personal bodyguard. Scorpion, the Hellspawn Spectre, who returns to the tournament in an attempt to assassinate Sub-Zero yet again. God help you if you're ever trying to play against him in the single-player mode, because dude was relentless, and he loved that stupid harpoon spear attack. That thing got me a bunch of times. But anyway, we also have some debuting characters as well. Baraka, my third of three favorite playable characters in the game. Baraka is an Outworld warlord who has blades surgically attached to his hands. There we go. That was my favorite move in the game. Baraka is responsible for the assault on the Shaolin Monastery, which in turn provokes Liu Kang and another debut character by the name of Kung Lao to enter the second tournament. Shaolin monk and close friend of Liu Kang, Kung Lao is a descendant of the great Kung Lao, who was defeated by Goro and Shang Tsung over 500 years ago. He enters the tournament to seek and avenge his ancestor, as well as avenge the destruction of the aforementioned Shaolin Temple. Next we have Jackson Briggs, aka Jax. Jax is a U.S. Special Forces officer who enters the tournament to rescue his partner Sonya Blade from Outworld. You remember Sonya Blade from the first Mortal Kombat. Katana, a female ninja who works as a personal assassin for Shao Kahn. The awesome thing about Katana is that she's the first sort of double agent in the Mortal Kombat series, as she secretly has been aiding the Earthrealm Warriors in both tournaments. Finally, we have Melina, Katana's twin sister, who also serves as an assassin for Shao Kahn. Her mission during the tournament is to ensure the loyalty of her sister, but she also has plans of her own, which, like all characters, will get further expounded upon as the series progresses. Again, what's not to love about this game? So many combination fighting moves exist in this game, it's mind-boggling. When I was 12, 13 years old, I think I had all of them down pat, and currently I do not. But anyway, the fatalities were awesome too, as some were harder to perfect than others, but once you got them down, you felt a huge gaming sense of accomplishment. The gameplay is pretty violent, but having come out in the 1990s, I think it pales in comparison to the violence shown in games, movies, and other media nowadays in 2016. You guys be the judge. Its entertainment factor far outweighs its bloodlust. Like its predecessor, this game's characters had much personality, and fans were always interested in the fate of a given character, hence why they've been featured in many films, literature, music, and television for the past 25 years. If you guys haven't seen the recently adapted web series Mortal Kombat Legacy, I recommend it for all Mortal Kombat fans, as it goes into the kind of origin and plight of each character with a little bit more depth. I left a link for the first season in the video's description, so it's definitely worth a watch. Again, thank you Midway Games for developing and publishing this gem. I've enjoyed every second of it. So now we'll move on to number 11. Number 11, MLB 2K6. Not only our first game on the countdown in the 21st century, but also our first sports game. So to a huge baseball fan like myself, this game was a godsend. Developed by Visual Concepts, this game was distributed by 2K Sports in 2006. Originally, I wanted to use a little grainier of a clip since it showcased the Chicago Cubs on the brink of a World Series win. Remember, I grew up just southwest of Chicago. You'll notice this instead is a clip of the Cleveland Indians playing the Cooperstown All-Stars, but we'll get back to them in a second. I made it a point to get as good as I could at this game, play as the Cubs in season mode, and get into postseason whenever possible. I think in hindsight, I did it to exact revenge on such a horrible season. Any Cub fan out there would remember that in 2006, it was quite a bad year. But hey, last year we broke a 12-game losing streak in post, and we beat the Cardinals in the division series. Now I know we lost to the Mets, but two very important milestones were achieved, I love how the Cubbies look this year, and I'll be in Wrigley Field on the 28th of April, where it looks like John Lester is going to get the start against the Atlanta Braves. Awesome times, but I digress. This game is awesome in that how much it lets you do and how much it lets you manage. You can manage your team's position shifts, your pitching rotation, you can default your batting orders against right and left-handed pitching if you'd like to, you can perform double switches, all of those strategies that baseball fanatics love as fans of the game. Any of you who grew up watching Sunday Night Baseball as a kid like I did too would remember that John Miller and Joe Morgan would act as the play-by-play and the color commentator respectively. They do so again here, and it actually feels quite knowledgeable and authentic. This game is just all in all right up a baseball fan's alley. Good times. So moving on to number 10. Number 10, Phantasmagoria. Oh man, I'm getting flashbacks just looking at this right now. Well, what can we say about this game? For starters, it fits so many genres, be it science fiction, fantasy, horror, action-adventure, etc. This game actually plays more like a movie than anything else, but that is what adds to its depth and its substance. I was so fascinated by this game as a young teenager, and like every other game on the list, I played it whenever I could. Developed and published by Sierra Online, the entire game was filmed in front of a green screen, and I believe it took more than a year to produce. We had the 1995 PC version of the game. So our protagonist, Adrian Delaney, a successful novelist, moves to a remote mansion off the coast of a small New England island with her husband, Don Gordon, who is a professional photographer. The mansion was previously inhabited and owned by a 19th century magician named Zoltan Carnavash. Carno was notorious for having practiced black magic, and he also had five wives who all died mysteriously. Hint, hint, nudge, nudge. Though unknowing of this, Adrian gets an ominous vibe the first night. She starts having nightmares immediately, and eventually the player has to guide her in exploring the estate as she quickly starts making strange discoveries. After opening a lockbox atop an altar, Adrian unknowingly releases Carno's demon, which promptly possesses her husband, and at this point, everything starts to go downhill. Sinister things start to happen. Don's soul becomes more and more possessed, and Adrian would soon find that Carno had violently murdered all five of his wives, and she can even envision him doing so. At this point, she has the world on her shoulders, as she not only has to forget that her husband's soul has been possessed, she has to escape him, and she ultimately has to escape the estate. Can she do so? Well, the game was very well written, and I mentioned before in so many words that it would have made a great movie. Carno is such a compelling villain that you almost forgive that he has no redeeming qualities as a human being. The game totally leans on the side of violence, and even though in some cases it feels like it is doing so just for gratuity or shock value, I think it's just trying to give a heightened sense of awareness and survival to the player. I mean, take the scenes where Carno murders his wives. You're basically thinking, good God, I just need to get off this premises. In the game, you're not totally helpless, though. There's a hint keeper at the bottom right-hand side of the screen. I'm sorry, at the bottom left-hand side of the screen, and a visual aid in the form of an eyeball at the bottom right-hand side of the screen. The eye aid lets you view your inventory up close to determine its usefulness in the game. Well, folks, I said there was going to be some spoilers on this video, and here's another one. Adrian eventually has to kill her husband Don in self-defense by impaling him when he is just about to decapitate her. He has become himself again, but he is mortally wounded, and Adrian mournfully has to flee the estate. And there's that look of shock on her face, which is the very last thing we see. You know, when the credits rolled, I thought, man, that was a frickin' awesome game. Where's the sequel? Well, there actually was a sequel called Puzzle of Flesh, but I never played it because as I progressed into my teens, started getting less into sports and video games and more into music and definitely girls. But anyway, Phantasmagoria, awesome game, recommend it to anybody. So that was number 10. Number 9, Guitar Hero 3, Legends of Rock. Well, here we have the second game of the 21st century on the countdown, and the first music-based one. Building on the success of the first two Guitar Hero games, which were published by Harmonix, Neversoft Entertainment developed this masterpiece and distributed through Red Octane in 2007. I happen to have the PS2 version of the game, and what would make me pick GH3 specifically for slot number 9 on this list? Like the first two games, one gets to learn a little bit about guitar playing, time signatures, and general fretwork. But here, Tom Morello and Saul/Hudson were kind enough to lend their likenesses to the game and even appear as bosses that you have to beat to progress further. I'm sure they did so for a small price. But anyway, it gives the game
A real sense of authenticity when it comes to music. Plus, most of these 73 playable songs are that given song's master recording, so you're playing the real thing. Note that you can faintly hear Queens of the Stone Age's 3s and 7s underneath me talking here. Please don't copyright strike me, Warner Brothers. I'm not claiming to own this music. But QOTSA, awesome band, by the way. I've seen them 5 times live. Folks, if you get a chance to, I totally recommend you do so, but I digress. I would say that from about 2007 to 2009, the Guitar Hero series was at its popularity peak, and there were so many things that I appreciated not only about this game, but the series in general. It's super fun to any music fan, and I'm talking music. Not pitch correction or beat correction software that a computer can play, and that it's eventually coupled with some pop icon's voice that is barely theirs to begin with. I'm talking music, where folks play their own instruments and continue to practice to perfect their own art and skill. That's how this game resonates. And on a lighter note, the game can be hilarious at times. Those of us who played it, we all had that over-the-top friend or family member who totally hammed it up when they were playing. I noticed that the more stage presence that someone had, the worse they actually were at the game. You know, doing things like synchronized guitar solos, tilting the neck on the guitar when they didn't even have star power, things like that, and just how funny it was when somebody really sucked at this game. You start hearing the plucky sound effects that the game would make when you hit the wrong chords, and eventually the crowd would boo you off stage, and you'd have to start over again. Good times, though, and the franchise is actually trying to make a comeback, so I wish Freestyle Games the best of luck, and even though I'm getting old, I may try to give Guitar Hero 7 a go in the near future. So, that was number 9. Number 8. Zelda 2. In 1987, Nintendo R&D4 released this masterpiece in Japan, and about a year later in the United States. This game has a lot of layers to it, so just bear with me. So several years after the events of this game's predecessor, Impa, the nursemaid of Princess Zelda, guides Link to the Tower of the North Castle, where a maiden lies in deep sleep. She then informs him that the maiden sleeping, his name is Zelda, Princess of Hyrule from a long time ago, and likely the origin of the Legend of Zelda. So moons ago, the Prince of Hyrule had tried to obtain the Triforce, a sacred triangle-shaped relic that represents power, wisdom, and courage, and thus it is the force that breathes life into the kingdom of Hyrule. Zelda refuses to tell him the location of it, so under the prince's orders, a magician unsuccessfully interrogates her before casting a sleeping spell on her. Unable to reverse the spell, the prince declares that all females born into the Hyrule royal family from that point on would be named Zelda, in remembrance of this great tragedy. So when you think about it, the name Zelda actually serves as more of a lament than a celebration. And here's where our poor protagonist Link gets called in again. Impa calls upon him to release 6 crystals into their rightful place in Hyrule to obtain the Triforce, which is the only action possible to reverse the spell. So as with the first game, Ganon's followers are seeking Link, and he has the patience of a saint, because if I was him, I'd have told Impa to piss off, reminding her that I busted my ass every day just a year prior, risking life and limb to defeat Ganon and restore Hyrule to its natural order, and now I have to do it again? Yes, Link, do it again you must. So the player has to guide Link throughout Hyrule, and this time, believe it or not, you're covering more ground than in the first game, if that's even possible. This game was very ballsy in the fact that it bared little resemblance to the first one. I mean, it had the brass to go in many different directions. Fans will note that The Legend of Zelda was viewed completely from an aerial view. This game does feature an aerial view for the Outer World map, but it also features side-scrolling areas as well, and there is a much larger world map than the one before. While the first game had to be played more strategically to advance, this one tests how combative and reflexive the player can make Link. The game then rewards you with experience points for doing so, which enables Link to perform magic spells, an ability he previously did not have. And this game also lets you mingle with the townsfolk as well, picking up hints and clues to progress into the further levels. A lot of action in this game, and I eventually could not handle it, and I probably crapped out about 90% of the way through. My father, however, was a trooper at this one. Anybody who's played this game in its entirety knows that Link's final battle is facing down his doppelganger, Dark Link. Now, I'd watched my pop battle Dark Link dozens of times and appreciated his effort since the game had long since worn me out. So on one Saturday evening, many moons ago, my pop had decided to tag me in to beat him because he just could not do it. He would play up to the point that Link's doppelganger would appear, he'd toss me the control, and I had at it. Believe it or not, I nailed him. If it wasn't on the first try, it was very soon after that, and I couldn't believe it. I mean, we had played this game for over a year with no cheats or guidebooks, and it was finally over. So huge sense of closure and accomplishment there, and I'll always remember that finish. Fans would note that this game was the second in a series of dozens, and that you'd have to be living under a rock for the last 30 years not to know that. I really wish I had more time to provide all the accolades towards the Legend of Zelda series in just one video, but we have to move on. Number 7.
Rock Band, the series. Well, you guys probably knew I was headed in this direction again because of number 9. This time I didn't discriminate, the entire series gets the number 7 slot. In 2007, Harmonix picked up right where they left off with Guitar Hero, and this time, they decided to give us more plastic instruments. I had any and every PlayStation 2 version of the games in this series, and I probably missed out on a lot of social calls in 3 years because of it. Another backstory on me here, I can play the drums a little bit. The reason being is that my father introduced me to a little band called The Who when I was 6 years old, and Keith Moon soon then became my idol. Obviously, not for the life that he led, but not a soul in my mind could or ever has touched his drumming skills, and I tried to mimic him as much as possible for about the next decade. To my mother, if you're out there listening, I know the bashing of all the makeshift drum sets I made from household items was quite annoying when I was a kid, but I appreciate you letting me have a creative outlet just the same. I played in short-lived bands as a teenager as well, but eventually bill paying, finishing college and working full-time, you know, all that fun adult stuff, became my time consumption until this series had dawned. How obsessively and geekily involved I was with this game is quite hilarious in hindsight. I used to have to travel constantly for my job, and I remember packing an extra bag for the plastic drum set to put up in my hotel rooms. That's unfortunately no joke. Oh man, what a dork, but it was super fun. And this actually builds up to a story. Remember on number 9 when I was talking about people hamming it up while playing Guitar Hero? I'm unfortunately no different. When I had some friends over at my apartment about 7 years ago, and I was drumming so hard, I actually broke the drum set while playing Wolf Mother's Joker and the Thief. When I say I broke it, I mean I broke one of the sticks, tore through the plastic on the snare, and accidentally deactivated one of the sensors. My friend, who to preserve her anonymity I'll call KL, was laughing so hard she almost peed herself a little bit. And shut up, KL, it was not that funny. Alright, who am I kidding? It was frickin' hilarious. And I'm sure the neighbors thought I was a real tool walking the drum set to my apartment complex's community dumpster the next morning, but screw them, most of them were real bags anyway. Alright, enough of my little stupid autobiography here. What is not to love about this game? It's a good friend and family uniter to any group of friends or families who like music, and like Guitar Hero, it teaches any single player a little bit about music, and it makes them pay homage to artists actually playing their instruments, and could maybe inspire someone to start playing a real instrument themselves. It heightened my appreciation for playing the drums, and it almost made me wish that I would have stuck with it and pursued it as a career, but we all make our own choices in life and the sun still sets. Alright, there I go, digressing again, but fond memories of this game, and man, I miss my 20s. So that was number 7. Number 6.
RBI Baseball. Yes, yes, yes. Like number 19 on this list, Namco gave us another gem here. This game started my love of baseball, and I had some of the funniest and fun times playing it as a kid on the 8-bit Nintendo Entertainment System. Some would argue that the game doesn't stand the test of time, because all of your players have the exact same build, and their skill in the game is limited, and there's so few players per team, blah blah blah, but I'll get to that in a minute. So since I'm a huge baseball geek, I'll expound on what teams exist in this game first. The game consists of 10 teams, 8 of which were the American and National League regular season division winners of 1986 and 1987 respectively. So that's the 1986 California Angels, Boston Red Sox, Houston Astros, and the then coked up New York Mets. 1987's teams consist of my personal favorite in the game, the Detroit Tigers. Next we have the 87 Minnesota Twins, the St. Louis Cardinals, and the San Francisco Giants. If you really wanted an advantage in this game, you could play as the 1987 National and American League All-Star teams, because those lineups were stacked. So, other than my love of baseball, what I loved about the game was that it was strategic and comical at the same time. Strategic in that you have 12 possible batters and 4 possible pitchers. Of the 4 pitchers, you'd have 2 possible starters, 1 mid-reliever, and 1 closer. So to baseball fans out there, you'll note that you're 9 short of a full roster, but the NES cartridges couldn't accommodate that much data back in 1987. Thus, you had to make your moves wisely, because you could have an empty bench real quick, but that's what made the game fun and challenging. The game was comical in that all of the players have the exact same build, and they're all white guys. Yes, even the late great Kirby Puckett. White. The game is furthermore comical in that your pitcher could tire by about the fourth inning. So much so that if you wanted to leave your starting pitcher in, you could very shortly start throwing 26-mile-an-hour curveballs. I'll say that again, 26-mile-an-hour curveballs, which my uncle, believe it or not, used to strike me out on. This game was third of all comical in the fact that I thought Mark McGwire's 49 home runs that season were legitimate. Whoa, hey Brian, didn't know you were going there. Yeah, I went there, whatever. Growing up in Illinois, it bums me out a little bit that the Cubs aren't in this game, but it's fair, because boy did they suck back in 1986 and 7. Oh well. They're doing awesome this year though, so fingers crossed. You know, I stated this game started my love of baseball, and I meant that. I remember that I played it before I started actually watching games with my dad growing up, and I used to think it was awesome when I got to see the real version of the game's players on TV. Awesome game, I still play it from time to time on an NES emulator that I have stored on one of my thumb drives, and to those of you interested, there is a version of this game you can download with 2015 teams on it if you're so inclined. Like the Mortal Kombat Legacy series, I've left a link in the description for you to find it. And before we move on to number 5, I will say go Cubs, and if not, go Nationals. Number 5. And here we have it. Well folks, we're getting into the home stretch of this list, and this is not the first time that developers R&D4 have appeared on it. They know how to make video games. You guys have been seeing a lot of Nintendo Entertainment System games of late on this list, and here you see another one as well. 1988's Super Mario Bros. 3. What is our objective here? Well, our happy-go-lucky Italian plumber brothers Mario and Luigi have returned again to rescue Princess Toadstool from Bowser, the humanoid of reptilian origin who has set up 7 different kingdoms for the brothers to conquer and conquer this game over and over again. I did. Who wouldn't love this game as a child or an adult? It looks awesome, it's engaging, and it's super fun to play. SMB3 is to video games what Feel Good Inc. is to songs. There's not much that Mario cannot do in this game either. Besides the gift of speed, invincibility, and firepower, this time around, he has also obtained more abilities. He can fly, he can become statuesque to avoid enemies, he has become a better swimmer, and he can now throw hammers. Dude has quite the arsenal here. Plus, the game has so many more secrets and hidden treasures than its predecessors, and it gives you the opportunity to earn an infinite amount of extra lives throughout card games, checkpoint timing, and things of that nature. I had friends growing up that would try to conquer this game as soon as possible, which you could do by obtaining both magic flutes that were available in World 1, and then using them to warp yourself to World 8, and every time I saw that technique, I would think, why would you want to do that? This game is so much fun to play all the way through, and it looks awesome. Unlike the game's predecessors, which just featured side-scrolling action, this game featured an outer world map, and it gave you the choice to complete the levels within them in any sequence that you wanted to. It's awesome that the game affords you that kind of discretion, and playing this game using no warps can be quite time-consuming, but why would you want to miss out on the desert, water, sky, ice, and pipelands? Actually, I struggled in Pipeland a little bit, but it doesn't matter. I was so glued to this game when it came out. I picked this one specifically in the series just because it had to be. It had to be. So many fond memories of this game. And it's so visually and mentally imaginative that it was no surprise that it resonated very well with fans too. It has sold over 17 million units across multiple platforms, and it will forever be remembered and enjoyed. Man, I'm getting reminiscent about my childhood again, but we're moving on. Number 4. Mike Tyson's Punch-Out. You guys can see we're having a hard time getting out of the NES vortex here, but here we are again back in 1987. Now some of you may be thinking, really Bri, your third boxing game on the list? Absolutely. So in order to improve upon the Punch-Out series, Nintendo, R&D3, and the producers decided to shorten our playable boxer this time, so that we could get a clearer view of our opponents.
They also decided to give him a name and a backstory. Little Mac, it's nice to meet you. Furthermore, they decided to expand on the plot of the game and give us a background music track during the fights. And finally, we have animated cutscenes as well as a password system for game-saving progress. So like the game's predecessors, it's the player's job to defend against your opponents and counter their attacks accordingly. This time we do have a wicked uppercut though, and we can use it by landing star punches on our opponents. Mac's ultimate goal is to ascend through the WVBA by defeating 14 boxers to eventually become the heavyweight champion. As you can see, we have some returning defenders and some newcomers as well. One of the many great things about this game is that each boxer has his own distinct personality and fighting style, so they all resonate memorably with the player, which just makes you want to play the game over and over again, as I did when I was a kid, and probably well into my teens. You have so many options as to how you choose to defend against your opponents as well, and after a while you start picking up on their tells, which allow you to attack them more aggressively. And one thing that it took me a while to figure out was that if you counterattack your opponent on the side he's attempting to attack you on, you'll do substantially more damage. Thus, if he throws a right, get him with as many lefts as possible. Mastering these techniques, you'll be able to TKO Glass Joe in less than a minute and a half, Von Kaiser in 66 seconds, the first Piston Honda in 2 minutes, the first Don Flamenco in 36 seconds, King Hippo in 63, Great Tiger in 2 minutes, the first Bald Bull in 2 minutes, and the second Piston Honda in 65 seconds. The game gets a little tricky once you get to our Russian friend Soda Popinski, because our opponent's moves get less predictable at this point, thus they are harder to time and harder to counter. Some of you guys may have seen my video entitled BM151 Plays Mike Tyson's Punch-Out for the first time in over a year, and to those of you who did, you'll note that from Soda Popinski on, I had to work a little harder, which was kind of how it was playing this game as a kid. Unfortunately, I didn't get past Super Macho Man that time around, as I always kind of struggled in timing Super Macho Man. But come to think of it, he was a cakewalk compared to Mike Tyson. I didn't beat Tyson until I was well into my teens, but I'll get onto that later. Another thing that resonates positively about this game while I'm talking about it is its intelligence and its humor. Like number 20 on this list, it breaks the fourth wall constantly. For example, you have Mac's trainer, Doc Lewis, a fan favorite, telling Mac to join the Nintendo Fun Club, which at the time was a Nintendo news periodical that existed at the game's release. Now, there are plenty of Easter eggs here too. Like here you hear a busy signal when entering Nintendo's old hotline as a password. Yeah, I kind of wonder what would happen if you dialed these numbers nowadays. Feel free to try it, tell me what happens. But it's just things like this that feel like the developers were just joking and hanging around with you at the time while you were playing the game. Anyway, back to Mikey. One of the hardest final bosses in video game history, if you're lucky enough to last the first 90 seconds, you have a chance of beating him. But that window is where he usually gets you with one punch. Once you beat him though, the sense of accomplishment was unparalleled by anything. And fans would agree, the game was extremely well received by fans and critics at its release, and it had much staying power as Nintendo sold in excess of 2 million units. Like RBI Baseball, I still have this game on an old thumb drive, and I'm probably never getting rid of it. Thank you R&D3 for this masterpiece, as it'll never be forgotten. I think this game was the one in the series that paved the way for the rest of them to come. So thanks again, and we're moving on to number 3. Grand Theft Auto 3. We have finally escaped the NES vortex, guys. We made it to our fourth game of the 21st century, and how about it? I was actually really torn here because I wanted also to include Grand Theft Auto Vice City on this list, and likely in this slot too, but Grand Theft Auto 3 had catalyzed the dawning of the rest of the series, so I had to be fair. Now, for those of you who are fans of WatchMojo.com, consider this the point in my countdown where GTA Vice City gets an honorable mention. But where do I begin on the game that you're currently looking at? Well, it's by far the most violent game on the countdown, but the violence is so gratuitous and cartoon-like that it almost resonates as comical as opposed to sinister. Maybe the game's developers wanted it to be that way, I'm not sure, but anyway. In order to improve upon the Grand Theft Auto series, DMA Design and Rockstar Games decided to create this action-adventure game played from a third-person view. It's the first game on the list in which the protagonist is an ambitious, violent mercenary. From any other person's perspective other than the player, our anti-hero Claude could even be considered a villain. However, it's still our job to see that he completes the missions and the objectives to progress the game's storyline. Like number 10 on this list, this game plays very much like a movie. The compelling and captivating thing about it is how much information is actually coming at you at once. The fact that you can have multiple objectives and missions running at one time can almost make you feel like you're on sensory overload. And even when you're not on a mission, you can freely roam about the game's open world and have the ability to complete option side missions if you'd like. These are good for picking up extra cash and weapons, as you'll definitely need both when you get into the game's higher levels. Or you could do like I did and just use every cheat code imaginable. Trust me, I would not have beaten the game otherwise. Anyway, what's the backstory here? While robbing a bank in Liberty City, Claude is shot and betrayed by his girlfriend Catalina, and though he survives, he is arrested and sentenced to 10 years in prison. While being transported in a prison van, our anti-hero and fellow prisoner by the name of 8-Ball, who happens to be my favorite side character in the game, are inadvertently freed after an attack on the police convoy, and they do escape to a safe house. At this point, it's your job to make Claude partake in either the game's missions or freely roam about Liberty City, which is composed of three boroughs. That would be Portland, Staten Island, and Shoreside. These islands are unlocked to any given player as the story progresses. 8-Ball later introduces Claude to the Leone Mafia crime family. They consist of Luigi Gottarelli, who is awesomely played by Joe Pantoliano, the Don, Salvatore Leone, Tony Cipriani, and the Don's son, whose name is Joey. While working for this family, Claude finds himself fighting the Colombian drug lords who are being led by Catalina and proliferating a new drug for Liberty City. Sal's trophy wife, Maria, takes a liking to Claude immediately, which causes Sal to grow suspicious, and he eventually lures Claude into a death trap, but Maria is able to save him just in time, and they both flee. At this point, Claude begins working for the city's Yakuza and its leader, Asuka Kazen, who happens to be Maria's close friend. Claude then exacts revenge on Salvatore by assassinating him and thus alienating himself from Portland, in which he becomes a marked man for just about the rest of the game. He then meets Ray Makowski, a disgraced police detective who also happens to be an enemy of the cartel. After he helps him flee the city, he meets a media mogul by the name of Donald Love, and together, they organize the death of Asuka's brother Kenji and blame the cartel in order to start an internal war between the cartel and the Yakuza. Told ya, Claude had mercenary-like tendencies. Anyway, Asuka abducts Catalina's partner Miguel, believing him to have knowledge of her brother's death, and as the war with the cartel intensifies, Asuka and Maria learn of Claude's history with Catalina and order him to attack any and all cartel operations. As a result, the cartel abducts Maria, murders Asuka and Miguel, and then demands $500,000 from Claude for Maria's release. Claude confronts Catalina, she attempts to have him killed again, but this time he escapes, and in the resulting firefight, Catalina attempts to flee in a helicopter and makes a final attempt on his life. He kills her, he kills the remaining cartel members, and as they leave the scene, Maria complains to him about the kidnapping, and while the credits roll, a gunshot is heard, and incidentally, Maria's voice is silenced. Now guys, I just gave you the condensed version of the game, but there's no way possible that I could give it all of the credit that it deserves. I mean, how about how open it is? Player can freely roam about the game and has the ability to use an array of weapons. You'll find that Claude can obtain quite the arsenal. Your firearms include weapons such as the Micro Uzi, the M16 rifle, a flamethrower, a rocket launcher, and my personal favorite, the sniper rifle. The player's precision and timing with the sniper rifle comes heavily into play during the Bomb the Base mission in Portland. This mission is where you provide cover fire for your partner 8-Ball while he attempts to detonate a cargo ship on which the Colombian cartel is operating. That mission is very, very difficult to complete, yet very adrenalizing, and you feel awesome when you do complete it. But again, I digress. As you roam about the three-dimensional open world, you can also make Claude run, jump, or steal vehicles to progress the game's navigation. Such criminal activity, though, will eventually up your wanted level, and before you know it, Liberty City's law enforcement agencies will be all over you, so my suggestion is if you're gonna maim and murder civilians, either do so discreetly or use the cheat codes to reduce your wanted level like I always used to do. Finally, I love the use of the radio stations in this game as well. You can tune through any one of them in a given car. We can select from the stations Double Clef FM, Flashback, Game Radio, Head Radio, Keja Radio, Lips 106, MSX FM, Rise FM, and finally my personal favorite, Chatterbox FM, which fans of Sirius XM will note contains radio personality Laszlo Jones, whose hilarious performance in GTA 3 serves as one of the most underrated of all characters in the game. Awesome times, though. So great work by DMA Design and Rockstar Games. They never disappointed here. That was number 3. Number 2, Eternal Darkness. I don't even know where to start with this masterpiece, so I'll try to praise, yet inform upon it as best I can. The game was the end result of the labor of Canadian video game producers the Silicon Knights, and man did they fire on all cylinders with this one. It was released for the Nintendo GameCube in 2002, and I think I want to buy everyone responsible for this game a drink, just as a token of my appreciation. The game falls into the action-adventure genre, but like number 10 on this list, it is so much more than that. I'd say Eternal Darkness is also a coming-of-age story, a psychological thriller, puzzle, a history lesson, a time travel adventure, and most importantly, I would say it's an implication of how human curiosity has contributed to how fragile humanity is and has been throughout the ages. Yes, this game goes very deep. So what's our story? The game centers around our main protagonist, Alexandra Roivas, a university student who has been summoned to Rhode Island by Detective LaGrasse of the state police to answer any questions related to the mysterious death of her grandfather Edward. Aggrieved, shocked, and enraged, Alex decides to do a bit of detective work herself. She starts to explore the estate and eventually finds herself in Edward's study. There she happens upon a book entitled The Tome of Eternal Darkness, which is bound with skin and bone. When she reads this book, she experiences a scene in the life of Pius Augustus, a distant ancestor of Alex's and a respected Roman military commander of the first century. While trying to retrieve an unknown artifact for his emperor, he is led by mysterious voices to an underground temple in Persia where he must battle off his impending enemies, and in the process, he finds 3 stones. These stones derive from what the game calls the Ancients. The Ancients are depicted as godlike beings that existed on Earth long before humanity. So of the stones, we have our red Shaturga, which is the god of strength, we have the green Zelototh, which is the god of sanity, and finally we have the purple Ulioth, which is the god of magic. Now the player needs to maintain a good supply of these 3 elements throughout the game, and I would say they especially need to maintain their sanity. Fear can cause your character's sanity to be negatively affected, which in turn can affect their perception of reality, cause hallucinations,
and can warp their mind so deep that eventually a given character will not be able to tell if something is actually happening.
So it's almost like a nightmare when it gets to that point. The clever thing that the game does is to put the person playing the game in their character's head, thereby causing you not to know if the game is actually progressing or if you're just losing your mind yourself. But as always, I digress. When Pius finds the artifact, it transforms him into an undead warlock who is enslaved to the Ancients. Through him, they try to establish their own reality on Earth. The Earthbound corpse god Mantarok is apparently the only one who can stop this. If the summoning came to pass, the Ancients would feast on the bodies and souls of all living beings, thus casting the universe into the horror of eternal darkness. So it is the player's job to play as several characters who are in a sense chosen to battle this impending eternal darkness, and each one of them has their own separate story. So we play as the following characters. We have Ilya, a 12th century Cambodian slave who was murdered by the possessed Pius for capturing Mantarok's essence and refusing to bring it to him. We have Anthony, a naive Frankish messenger in the 9th century. He is acting on orders from Emperor Charlemagne, but fails to save him from a group of treacherous monks, and eventually Anthony is murdered himself.
Karim,
a 6th century Persian swordsman who was warned of the artifact's true nature by the ghost of his wife Chandra. He then martyrs himself to preserve humanity by watching over the artifact. We have Maximilian Roivas, an 18th century American doctor and 6th great-grandfather to Alex. Max discovers the underground temple, defeats one of the artifact's guardians, and is eventually committed to an insane asylum where he unfortunately succumbs to his own death. we have Edwin Lindsay, an American archaeologist who in Cambodia eventually finds the undead remains of Elia, who gives him Mantarok's essence, which he then returns to the United States and delivers to Edward Roydus. We have Paul Luther, a 15th century Franciscan monk who finds that during the Inquisition, his brother Andrew was killed to protect a secret, which is that the ancient relic is hidden in the Amiens Cathedral. Well, Paul's knowledge of Andrew's knowledge leads to his demise as well. Pius is quite the villain. I wouldn't put any other one of them in this countdown against him for a day. We have Roberto Bianchi, a 15th century Italian architect who was taken as a POW while working abroad. Forced to work for Pius in constructing a pillar of flesh, he acquires the artifact from Karim while surveying the monster-infested site, and when his work is complete, he is unfortunately thrown into the pillar and buried alive. We have Peter Jacob, a field reporter during World War I, who notices that people are mysteriously disappearing from the field hospital he is staying in. His investigation concludes that people are actually being killed by the same guardian responsible for Paul's death, and when he emerges victorious over the guardian, he keeps the artifact for many years until he eventually delivers it to Edward. So now you can probably start seeing why Edward was a marked man. We have Edward Roydus, the game's narrator and Alex's grandfather. Edward eventually defeats and wipes out the forces of the Underground Temple with a massive dispel magic trick that causes the demise of most of the remaining guardians of the Ancients. Needless to say, they are none too happy, and they use one of the remaining guardians to bring about Edward's death in the year 2000. Finally, we have Michael Edwards, a firefighter sent to Kuwait during the Gulf War. As an explosion leaves him trapped in the Forbidden City, he becomes the sole survivor, and it is there where he receives the essence of an ancient from Roberto. Years later, he gives a package to Edward. Though the contents of the package are never revealed, we have a strong suspicion that Edward was murdered because of them. So this is where you start to feel for your protagonist. Not only has Alex lived all of the horrifying experiences of the aforementioned characters, she has lost her last living relative, and now she must destroy the remaining ancients to preserve humanity? Oh, the poor thing. If she lives, she's totally going to be a candidate for PTS. She doesn't have to go at it alone, though, as she is aided by the spirits of the game's aforementioned characters. She eventually emerges victorious over Pius and the Ancients, and as the game comes to a close, it is revealed that Mantarok manipulated the Roivas family into completing his work for him. In the end, only the corpse god Mantarok is still alive, festering in his tomb, plotting. However, on a positive note, Alex is given accolades by her late grandfather Edward, as he expresses much gratitude and pride, and you're left with a sense that humanity will be alright, at least for now. Unbelievable game. I haven't played it in 11 years, but my father was kind enough to pass it off to me my last birthday. Thanks, Pop. I'll definitely give it another go. Well, folks, you only have to hear me speak for so much longer. We have finally arrived at number 1. The Legend of Zelda. Some of you guys may have known that I was going in this direction, some of you may have not. But let me just start by saying, whoever has not played this game, you're in for a rewarding experience if you do. This is probably the most iconic action-adventure game to ever exist, and it still stands the test of time. For my money, it's probably the coolest commercial release of anything in the 1980s. R&D4 and Nintendo make their final appearance on this list, and they knock it out of the park with this one too. So what is our story? Again, we take on the role of Link. Like number 8 on this list, we're back in Hyrule, a kingdom that is plagued by chaos after just having been invaded by Ganon. Ganon goes on to kidnap Princess Zelda, but before he can do so, she splits the Triforce of Wisdom into 8 sections and distributes them throughout the kingdom of Hyrule, and it is our job to defend against Hyrule's enemies in both the overworld map and 9 underground dungeons to obtain each section of the Triforce, eventually defeat Ganon and rescue Princess Zelda, thus restoring Hyrule to its natural order. And what a trip it is to do so. Pretty much everyone who grew up as a child in the 1980s played this game. It took me over a year to beat, and I had no guidebook or cheat codes to do so. In hindsight, I didn't even complete the game in order. If you guys remember, the game's dungeons were to get much harder as the game progressed. Well, I remember, I didn't even have the second sword yet when I accidentally stumbled upon World 5 as I was just trying to escape the Lost Hills in the northeastern section of the overworld. Now, can you imagine trying to fight off those mummified corpses with that little brown piece of crap? Needless to say, I got my ass kicked playing this game a bunch of times at the beginning, but that's what actually made it a lot of fun, and it made it very challenging. Because the player does not have to progress the game in a linear fashion. He or she can pretty much wander around until they find something of use, or they find something interesting, and pretty much decide to play the game at their own pace. It has quite the inventory, too, once you get going. My personal favorites were the raft, because it enabled water navigation, and I personally loved the magic wand and the Book of Magic, because they gave Link infinite short and long-term firepower within a given level. But I'm getting ahead of myself. One thing to help keep you pursuing your inventory is to keep your health up. You can do this by obtaining as many heart containers as possible. A lot of them can be found by bombing down certain walls in the overworld, so it's wise for the player to collect as much currency, known in the game as rupees, to buy as many bombs as possible. You can do so by killing off lesser enemies in the game, and you can also obtain currency by playing card games with the local merchants and townsfolk. It's wise to stock up on as much inventory as possible before hitting the dungeons. Now, the dungeons serve as almost unique characters of the game in of themselves. The cool thing about them is that each of their blueprints derive from an Eastern Buddhist symbol. Level 1 being the eagle, level 2 being the moon, level 3 being the manji, level 4 being the snake, level 5 being the lizard, level 6 being the dragon, level 7 being the demon. Funny thing about level 7 is you can access it by obtaining the magic flute in level 5, which you'd also see in the Mario Brothers series, so little inside baseball here from R&D4. Finally, we have level 8, the lion. Now, each of these levels are constructed in a maze-like fashion, and all of them are connected by doors and secret passages, and they also all contain new weapons and bosses. Defeating a given boss allows Link to obtain new sections of the Triforce, and once he has obtained all of the artifacts, he can enter the ninth dungeon to rescue Zelda. And oh my god, guys, this level is one of the hardest levels in any given game, no matter what the time frame or what platform you're playing on. I had mentioned earlier that it took me over a year to complete this game, and I gotta think that of that year, I spent about 6 months just in this dungeon. And this was the Nintendo 8-bit days, which means that if you died, you'd have to navigate to the level each time from the beginning of the overworld. And how freaking trying was this to anybody who played this game back in the 1980s? I remember my father, my uncle, and I would keep a notebook at our side when we played the game because we'd forget where we had to navigate if we didn't write it down. And that may sound archaic to gamers of the 21st century, but believe it or not, this game required some deductive reasoning, some short-term memory, and it almost required a syllabus to get further into it. After you complete the game, though, you feel like a rock star, and that you can now take on anything in the virtual world. The game recognizes this, trust me. So then they award you a second quest, which is way more even difficult than the first one, believe it or not. I don't even think I made it a tenth of the way through the second quest, as it just is about 10 times harder than the first one. So to those of you that were able to, congratulations. Anyway, The Legend of Zelda was very well received in the gaming community as well. Computer Gaming World named it the best adventure game of the year. It went on to sell over 6.5 million units the first year it was available in the United States, and it has since spawned 17 sequels that are available on dozens of platforms to the current day. Keep forging ahead, Link. And thank you, Nintendo, for this masterpiece. I will forever hold it in high regard. Well, folks, that's my time. I appreciate you hanging out today, and happy gaming, guys.